The elder unto the elect, that's John, and the elder, the apostle John. No, he was the apostle that laid his head on Jesus' chest. He was always real close to Jesus. And the Bible says Jesus loved him. And as I say, John, he keeps speaking to his leg lady. Now, I saw in a commentary that leg lady's name was Martha, but he says his elect unto the elect lady and her children, whom I love in the truth, and not only, but also all they that have known the truth. And Jesus made it plain, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. The truth is Jesus Christ. Neither is there salvation in any other. There is no other name under heaven that is given among men whereby we must be saved. That's Jesus Christ. For the truth's sake, which dwelleth in us, shall be with us forever. Grace be with you, mercy and peace from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the Father, in truth and love. I rejoice greatly that I found of thy children walking in truth. And that's amazing as I look at this section here. I walk in truth even the day because of a mother. My mother led me to Jesus Christ. This book is a little boy. Before I went into school, she would read little Bible verses. And I remember how I got attuned to Samson, who slayed, I told you this before, he slayed 1,000 Philistines with the ass, with the bone of an ass. And I fell in love with David, the great king, who actually killed a lion, he killed a bear, he killed that great fellow in Goliath. And my mother didn't get that much college education, didn't get any education, hardly. I don't think she graduated, because I'm looking at papers now that my wife has died. And I was on one of the marriage certificates with my dad. She was only 14 years old. Only 14. She hadn't even finished high school. And her mom and dad had the sign to her to marry my dad back in Mobile, Alabama. What a profound woman she was. I remember she told me that little boy. She told me how to pray. Now lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I could die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to keep. And even now, sometimes in the long road I've traveled, some, even in the military, when things got real tough, I remember I would always kind of bring up that little voice and meditate on it. And then she would tuck me in and give me a little squeeze. And I would sleep the rest of the night. I even meditate on that even a lot since my wife is also going home to be with the Lord. I'm coming up to now lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I could die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. She led me to Christ right there by my bedside around 3 years old, I think, or four. She led me to Christ right there along the bedside. I rejoice greatly that I found of thy children walking in the truth. I walk in the truth because another thing she did is I'm even experiencing now. She taught me and my brothers how to cook. And even though a lot of you guys have brought food over since the death of my wife and a lot of my neighbors take them even to Longhorn Steakhouse the other day. But you know what I really love? She taught me how to cook mashed potatoes and gravy, Brussels sprouts, and a little piece of roast that I've been cutting over about 4 or 5 days. My mother taught us how to cook. Now, my dad saw that. He didn't like that. He came in the kitchen and tried to run us out. But she was strong and physical, and she said, no, you don't. And don't ever get stuck through with them. She taught me how to cook. So don't worry about feeding. I lost a lot of weight because of the surgery they anticipated, and I'm on a liquid diet, but I haven't lost weight because I don't have food. My mother told us how to cook, like I said, so I'm even living on that. Now, Maxine, my wife, never allowed me in the kitchen. She was a food food. Now that she's going home to glory, I'm cooking a lot. I never cooked as much as I'm cooking. But I'm following my mother's recipes. So what a great woman she was. Now, I rejoice greatly that I found of thy mother walking in truth that we have received a commandment from the Father. And now I beseech thee, lady, not as though I wrote a new commandment unto thee, but that which we have had from the beginning, that we love one another. And as my mother would do, because what was so great about her too, she wouldn't embarrass me like my dad. I remember second page, the great black picture, made me strike out about 3 times. And my dad came out on the field and embarrassed me. Boy, I'm ashamed of you. He came way out there, you won't let him threat. I said, Dad, don't too many people put wood on Statue of Page. They didn't really put no wood on Statue of Page for me to Major League in 55, Cleveland, Indiana. But my mother was wise. Like I say, my friends had comic books, like Superman. Hank Aaron's two favorite comic books were Superman and Captain Marvel. My favorite heroes were Samson and David. Matter of fact, I would get into arguments with them. My mother was wise. She would leave the door open and she would hear through the screen. And when my buddies would leave, she would straighten me out. When I got inside, they looked, don't go too far with that. Say, God did that too, David. God did that too, Samson. So she was wise. She wouldn't embarrass me like my dad. I'm ashamed to be in the stands looking at you striking out twice. But she would be real wise and cool at all and help me to see it wasn't David killing a lion. It wasn't Samson killing a thousand Philistines. Jesus working through both of them, and that gave me real understanding of the scriptures. And this is the love, the last verse, and this is the love that we walk after his commandments. This is the commandment that as we have heard from the beginning, that you should walk in it. If we should walk in love, we should love God with all our heart, we should love our neighbors as ourselves. As a matter of fact, there's a voice that says, we should love our neighbors better than ourselves. So I'm walking in love, so Father, let's pray. Well, I just pray that Pastor comes today and talk about these wonderful verses on Mother's Day, Father. He would help our mothers realize they have the greatest position in all of society. They have their children in the formative years. They can shape them into becoming great people for Jesus Christ. Oh, Lord, if people like this great man in Russia had a godly mother, I'm sure he wouldn't be slain all those people. Lord, if we had leaders who had Jesus Christ as a savior, a mother who could tell them about the Lord, we would have a much better society. Oh, Father, be with your word and Pastor comes and lead some person to Christ. Pray that any mother here without Christ, this would be the day that after Pastor brings the word, she would accept Christ as a savior and become a great influence on her children, but they were going out to accept Christ. Lord, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Ed. Part of our Mother's Day celebration is baby dedication. So we have with us the Conway family for round number 2 of babies. If y'all want to come on up, we are wanting to dedicate and celebrate the gift of life. I always like to remind everyone as we celebrate baby dedications that we are Baptists. And so what a baby dedication is and isn't, this is not to be confused with infant baptism. But rather what it is that we are celebrating the gift of life from the Creator of life and to celebrate the gift of family, husband, wife, mother, father, family. And we are wanting to celebrate that today. Psalm 127 says, unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the guards stand watch in vain. In vain you rise early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat. For he grants sleep to those he loves. Children are a heritage from the Lord, offspring a reward from him. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are children born in one's youth. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. They will not be put to shame when they contend with their opponents in court. I love that phrase that children born in one's youth. I've been a minister long enough. Many of you all know a few weeks ago I got to preach at the church I first served as a youth pastor. And one of my favorite parts of ministry is to see students now as adults, as spouses and parents. And Hunter and Kaylee very much fit that mold here. They were young pups when we first came. Hunter was as tall and big as he is now as he was then, right? So 6'3" linebacker for the Oakland Raiders, right? Not Vegas. We don't do the Las Vegas Raiders. It's Oakland Raiders where they belong. But and I've watched both give their lives to Christ And we baptized both, and now graduated high school and get married and everything, and now two kids. And what a blessing they've been to me and to our church. And today we are wanting to celebrate the latest addition, Little Raider, as it says on his birth certificate. At least that's what I told him to put on the birth certificate. This is Bryson Lane Conway, born October 10th, 2021. I love the date October 10th because I got to do math. 13 years before that, Elijah was born October 10th. See, I can do math. I don't even know what's going on in county. Fun little fact of little Bryson is his favorite hobbies include eating, jumping in his jumper room, grabbing Sutton's hair, and rooting for the Louisville Cardinals. You see that? He's a Gator fan.
Ooh, that was the worst.
Yeah. No one asked you, Andy. I'm making fun of Andy over here. Well, we can't all raise our children perfectly, but
roll tide.
Oh, God.
Well, anyway, I'll just stop there. But we want to celebrate Hunter and Kaylee and Sutton and Bryson. What a gift they have been. So, Hunter and Kaylee, I want to ask you to commit today to the raising of Bryson. Do you promise to keep your home intact, not let Satan have a victory, not to divorce and raise your children God's way, to be a model of the gospel for this child, and will you this day dedicate your child to the glory of the Lord Jesus? How about we pray for Bryson, we pray for Sutton, and we pray for their parents. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, thank you for your love and your mercy. Thank you for the gift of life, especially in a culture that celebrates death. We thank you for the gift of love in a culture that is stuck with lust. Here we have a picture of the gospel. Man and wife, children. We are reminded as the bride of Christ, we have been loved with an eternal love that will, and we look forward to the day that we will celebrate the marriage supper of the Lamb. What a picture of the gospel we have here. Of unconditional love for husband and wife, that when the two become one, the one become many. And we celebrate this picture. And we understand that this is a picture that is bizarre in the world we live in, but it is beautiful, and it is your design for all of us. So what I lift up to you, Hunter and Kaylee, that they may grow in Christ as individuals and as a couple. That true intimacy is seen, not just physically, emotionally, but spiritually. That you would bless them as they grow in the gospel. I've seen them up close as they've grown, and to see where they were, where they are. What a blessing of faithfulness the gospel and your spirit are. But Lord, we lift up to you their children. That as their marriage grows, that their family is blessed because of us. We lift up to you Sutton, who has been a real blessing in our church, and now Bryson. As we have started to watch him grow, it's hard to believe that he is already as though it is he is now. And we ask that, first of all, Lord, that you would save their souls. And we ask that you would sanctify them to be the young men that you've called them to be. So, Lord, we hand Bryson over to you, that you would give his parents wisdom as they raise him, that you would guide every step that he takes, that he would live a life that is for your good and your glory. Lord, we ask that you would draw more families to Christ. More families to build their homes around the gospel. Will you use us? Will you strengthen us in our home, in our marriages, and in the world around us? In the name of your glorious Son, we pray. Amen. The ladies want to present a gift. Certificate is a pre-contract with the Oakland Raiders. So don't sign with Adiyah. Deuteronomy 6, verse 4 says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts and bless them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, and when you lie down, and when you get up." Thank you.
If you will please rise. Who am I? that the Lord of all the earth bears all my sin, we care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright morning star would choose to light the way and prepare a wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower's place with fading in the fading of tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. You can hear me when I'm calling, or you catch me when I'm falling. It's only who I am.
Thank you. Yeah.
I don't know why God made one dead in the apartment's outstate. I don't know why he made hometowns if it's somewhere I can't stay. I don't know why he made grown up, but I can't stay here, I'm gonna. Yeah, I don't know a lot of things, but I know why God made bombs. Well, I know that I'm gonna do. Dream don't go your way. We're always giving more than taking. We're always knowing what you need. Showing you that fighting's always best on your knees. For the open arms to come to. For the way you don't know what to do. For the phone calls saying don't forget. I'm always in the corner. For the heart that makes a house of fun.
To pursue the wisest of women. So our question here today is, what does that phrase mean? What does it mean to be the wisest of women? Sometimes in the Proverbs, you'll see it described as the virtuous woman or the excellent wife or something to that nature. What does Solomon mean by the wisest of women? What does it look like practically? Remember, the Proverbs are pithy, practical sayings of wisdom meant to put into practice. Well, first thing the wisest of women does is she crowns. She crowns. When people complain about male headship, I find that it is clear that they are unfamiliar with what Scripture actually says about gender or marriage. Men are called to leave their home. That is very clear in both the Old and the New Testament. The husband is described in the Bible as the head of the household. The Scripture is equally clear the role of women. The man is to be the head. The wife is to be the crown of the head. A well-crowned man leads well, loves well, and lives well. The old saying that behind every successful man is a strong woman certainly rings true. And as you'll see, and I put a lot of these verses in your notes for the sake of time, because we will be doing some bouncing around. But Proverbs 12:4 is a very important verse in this realm. An excellent wife is the crown of her husband. She who brings shame is like rottenness in his bones. It's interesting, isn't it? The wisest of women, according to Solomon, does not merely adorn herself, and Proverbs, if we had time, explores that issue. She doesn't merely just adorn herself, she adorns her husband. She is a crown of glory for him. And this language of crowning the husband is found throughout Proverbs. In fact, I was studying this week, I couldn't help but think, like, that is a beautiful imagery. I have no idea what it means, right? You ever do that, right? Like, I love that. That sounds really profound. No idea what it means. But if you study that the other passage that mentions crowning, I think we get a real insight of what it means here. For example, Proverbs 4, verse 9 says, "Wisdom will place on your head a graceful garland." She will come back to that, the feminization of wisdom. "She will bestow on you a beautiful crown." It's the same language there, isn't it? Or consider Proverbs 16. "Gray hair is a crown of glory, and for once in my life, praise the Lord," that verse is in there, right? That's right, yeah. Yeah, some of you dark-haired human beings, like, no, I don't want to hear from you. Gray hair, God loves us more than the rest of you, okay? I'm the youngest of three kids and the grayest of three kids. Now, my brother is trying to catch up. Much like trying to catch up to me in height. Gray hair is a crown of glory. It is gay. There it is in the Bible, y'all. A righteous life. See? We are better than you. Right? This is just the way it is. It's right there in the Bible. Or grandparents. Think of this. Chapter 17, verse 6. "Grandchildren are the crown of the aged, and the glory of children is their father." Notice there the connection between glory and crowning. Honor and crowning. Whether it is we're talking about a life lived in wisdom, whether we are talking about a life lived in righteousness, or the glory of raising children. So you can go back to chapter 12. An excellent wife, a virtuous wife, the wisest of women, are a crown to their husband. You'll notice there in chapter 12, verse 4, that there's this contrast. And that's typical of Proverbs. You usually get the good and the bad, the wise and the fool, the lazy and the hardworking one, right? You get this all the time throughout Proverbs. And this verse is no different. On the one hand is the wife who crowns her husband. On the other hand is the wife who brings shame to her husband. And the comparison is important. Such a wife, the excellent wife, brings her husband honor by honoring him. She is gracious and respects him. She supports him and is patient with him. Doing so crowns him. Just as a king without a crown is incomplete, so a husband is incomplete without the crown of his wife. The wisest of wives honor her husband, not like a serf to a king, but like a crown to a king. There is reason why so many people will look at a man and say, "He clearly is knocked it out of the park with a wife." There's a reason for that. Have you ever looked at a wife and said, "Wow, I would have never thought you could get someone like him"? That never happens. There's a reason for that. What's that? Men marry up, women settle. Let's be honest, right? But how a woman strengthens a man is incalculable. Throughout Proverbs, Solomon reminds his son, remember this Proverbs primarily written to a son from a father, regarding his life. He reminds his son that loving and marrying a godly woman is a genuine blessing from God that will make him rich beyond wealth. In fact, we can say that there are plenty of rich, powerful people who make poor decisions in their home life and are more miserable than a poor, forgotten man who is crowned by a noble wife. In fact, I can prove that in the Bible. Proverbs 18, verse 22, he who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. See, men, if you have gray hair and you have a noble wife, you are truly blessed by God. Likewise, Proverbs 19, 14, house and wealth are inherited from fathers, but a prudent wife, that comes from the Lord. Proverbs 31, 10, I'm sure we know it well, an excellent wife. Who can find one? Right, young men? Who can find one? Well, when you do, you'll find she is, her worth is far more than riches. In fact, that word there, excellent, you see it there, excellent wife. You come back to it over and over in Proverbs. It's an interesting word. I didn't know this. It's a military term. You can translate it strength, might, efficiency, or even army. Can I prove it to you? In Exodus, right, remember, Pharaoh's army? The word for army is the same word used here for excellence. A military wife. An excellent wife. An efficient wife. A strong wife. A mighty wife. Who can find such a woman? In fact, in his commentary, Longhorn notes, quote, the basic meaning of the term is strength and power. And it can be applied to a variety of people, including a warrior, that is someone who's powerful, a functionary, someone who is able, or even a landowner, someone who is wealthy. While this indicates that noble here may not be military per se, the fact that the poem will associate military language not with men in this passage, but with a woman, suggests that the composer intends the reader to recognize warrior imagery here. In what follows in Proverbs 31, we see a woman who is engaged in the battle of life, dealing with people and winning an advantage for her family. The culture tells women they are only good enough so long as they are like men. And they call this equality. But according to the Bible, equality isn't something you earn, it is something you are given by nature as image bearers of God. It is a gift of creation. Women, particularly wives, need not compete with men, but rather be the crown of your husband, an honor that is greater than being like another guy. Second thing is she invests. She invests. Everyone invests in things they value the most. And as many point out, all you have to do is look at both your calendar and your expenditures, and you'll see what exactly it is that you invest in. In Proverbs, there are two things that the wisest of women invest in, at least for our purposes, sake of time, two things worth looking at. The first is her husband. Turn with me quickly to Proverbs 31. You know you can't do Mother's Day without reading Proverbs 31, right? Proverbs 31. You'll notice that the husband is referenced several times in this chapter. And remember, it is not written to women. It's written to the sort of woman men should pursue. Pursue the wisest of women. Pursue a godly woman. Pursue the excellent wife. So the husband is referenced particularly verse 11, verses 28, 29, so on and so forth. And from his perspective, he holds his wife up high. He honors her. And she's described in verse 10 as the excellent wife. We talked about this. Verse 11, a trustworthy wife. Verse 12, a respectful wife. Verse 13 to 19 in description as a hardworking wife. Verse 20, she's described as a generous wife. Verse 23, a proud wife. Verses 25 to 26 is both a strong and wise wife. And in verse 28, a blessed wife. The best summary, I think, comes in verses 11 and 12. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not hard all the days of skip down to verse 28. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently. You surpass them all. You see that she makes an investment in her husband. The center of her life is the investment of her home, investment of her husband. And that leads, secondly, we've already mentioned, she invests in her home. She invests in her home. In partnership with her husband, she secures a place for her home. Proverbs 14:1, again, we saw this, the wisest of women builds her house. Or we could even add Proverbs 19, which says, a foolish son is ruin to his father, and a wife's quarreling is a continuing dripping of rain. House and wealth are inherited from fathers, but a prudent wife is from the Lord. It is clear that she invests in her husband and she invests in her home. By the way, both are important. What I find that typically happens is a young couple invests in each other, and then when children come, the husband is surprised to find that her full investment is now in the kids. That is good, and that is awesome, and that is good. The problem is often that the husband feels like, well, where did I fit in this equation? For example, I always teach my wife about this. We first got married, our house was littered with wedding photos. Do you remember this? Remember those days? And then I thought, this is the way it's always going to be. Right? We moved to the parsonage, we're new parents, and everything is the way. Our marriage. We have kids. And you wouldn't even know we ever got married. It's up close pictures of their cheeks when they're infants, and toes, and feet, and all that sort of stuff. And grandparents holding the babies, and strangers holding the babies, and people I haven't talked to in years. You came by and want to hold the baby, picture of them holding the baby. What you didn't have was pictures like, hey, we got married. You remember that? Give me one picture up on the wall, right? I didn't have to be in, right? Just you in the wedding gown. We paid a lot for that. A picture would be nice. But the investment of both house and husband are important. In fact, while you're there in Proverbs 31, you see it there, isn't it? In verses 13, 19, and 31, she works with her hands. Verse 14, she works with a purpose. Verse 15 and 18, she works long hours. In verse 16, she works with faithfulness. In verse 27, it just says that she works really hard. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idols. She just works. She invests in her home. And so with that said, can we finally say that the work of a mother, whether you're a stay-at-home mom or not, is a job that never ends, and it is genuine work. Genuine work. An investment in one's home, an investment of one's husband, family, marriage, is a greater investment than one's portfolio or retirement. Invest in your home. Well, I want to skip to the next point, and then if you're keeping score in your notes, it's she protects. And the two main points there is she affirms verbally, she loves physically. But I want to move on, finally, to she, the wisest of women, worships. She worships. The root of everything of the wisest of women is her faith. In fact, you see this in Proverbs 31, verse 30, isn't it? There, near the very end of the book, charm is deceitful and beauty is vain. Now, he's not saying those things are bad. We've done a whole study on beauty before in our study of Genesis. Charm is deceitful, beauty is vain, but here's the most important thing. A woman who fears the Lord is to be praised.
Amen.
Now, what does that mean? Much as it was a mystery to say the wisest of women, right? What does that exactly mean? What does it mean to fear the Lord? Not just fear the Lord. What does Solomon in the Proverbs mean by fear the Lord? Well, I don't think it's an accident that Proverbs ends by saying that a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Because it begins in a very similar way. And throughout Proverbs, we see essentially the same thing. Remember we saw this earlier, that wisdom was feminized? In fact, Lady Wisdom, earlier in the book, is a woman who speaks. She speaks wisdom, and this is where the Greek, her name is Sophia. Sophia is the Greek word for wisdom. So what we've done is we've given her a name. Her name is Wisdom, Sophia. Well, what you'll find is that wisdom in Proverbs is feminized. So Proverbs 1:20, wisdom cries out in the streets and the markets, she raises her voice. Proverbs 7:4, say to wisdom, you are my sister, and call insight your intimate friend. Proverbs 8:1, does not wisdom call? Does not understanding raise her voice? You see that, ladies? You've always known you're the wise one of the family, right? The Bible's right there with you. That song is like, well, I'm not going to make wisdom a dude. No one will read the book. It won't be believable. Maybe a woman. And so you begin with Lady Wisdom, personified in this philosophical approach, but it ends with Lady Wisdom, who's a real woman who loves her house, she loves her husband, she loves her home. So what does it mean then for a woman to fear the Lord? What does she look like? Let me give you two things again. We'll see what Proverbs has to say about fear and we'll apply. First of all, it means that she is wise. Proverbs 1:7 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and judgment. You see it there? The beginning of knowledge, the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord, which means there are a lot of smart people with degrees and television shows and best-selling books. They are fools for one simple reason. They do not fear the Lord. Give me a man or a woman who fears the Lord without education, without wealth, without any of that, and they'll change the world. He's done it once. He did it with 12 disciples. Proverbs 19, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The knowledge of the Holy One is inside. What is the woman who fears the Lord? She is wise. She walks in wisdom because she lives in the fear of the Lord. Secondly, she is righteous. She is righteous. She says, fear is the root of wisdom. So too, the fear of the Lord is the root of righteousness. Proverbs 3:7, be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord. Turn away from evil. The fear of the Lord, chapter 8, is the hatred of evil. Pride and arrogance in the way of evil. Pervert his speech. It's not real complicated, is it? Do you fear the Lord more than you fear man? Do you fear the Lord more than you than your own desires? Fear the Lord and you will pursue righteousness and good. We can keep going. Chapter 15. The fear of the Lord is instruction and wisdom. Humility comes before honor. Notice there. Now we're applying not just turning away from evil, we're adding humility. It is the result of fear of the Lord. He's in control. I'm not. By steadfast love and faithfulness. Iniquity is atoned for. And by the fear of the Lord, one turns away from evil. Notice there. When we fall, we have atonement. That's the beauty of the gospel. What we also have is because of the gospel, we turn away from the Lord. Isn't that what wisdom is? Righteousness made real. Proverbs 23:17, let not your heart envy sinners, but continue in the fear of the Lord all the day. And so it ends. Charm is deceitful, beauty is vain. The woman who fears will be praised. Returning to chapter 31, I want you to notice this. Wherein does she set her identity? When you read verses 11 and 28 and 29, you think it is because she's adorned by her husband and children. That's her identity. You read verses 12 to 14, 16, 19, 24, you may think her identity is the fact that she's a very gifted entrepreneur. She sells things, and makes a profit. You may think in verse 15 it's because she's a good cook. You may think in verse 20 it's because she's generous with all that she is good. You may think in verses 17 and 25 it's because she is strong and dignified. You may think in verse 21, it's because she provides well for her family. Or verse 22, it's because she is fashionable. There it is, ladies. Verse 23, it's because her husband has a great reputation. Verse 26, maybe because she is wise or kind. You may think it's because she's a hard worker in verse 27. Or because she is beautiful in verse 30. That's not where our identity lies. Our identity lies in the truth. She fears the Lord. And everything else comes from that. Her entrepreneurship, her hard work, her reputation, her love, her kindness, her generosity, her beauty, everything comes from the fact she is wise and she is righteous because she loves the Lord. So who is the wisest of the Lord? In a nutshell, she worships her Savior, honors her husband, loves her children, serves her neighbors, and walks. gracious woman is and deserves honor. We should make a holiday when we put that in practice. In 1835, French thinker Alex de Tocqueville, I never can pronounce his name, he's French, we don't care, right? Actually, this guy we do care about, very significant what it is he did. He toured America, and this is really the mid-19th century. He wanted to know, what is it that makes America different? What does it make America different? And he pointed out a number of things. You've probably come across this book before. His conclusion is fascinating. Can I read it to you? Now that I am drawing to the close this work, in which I have spoken of so many important things done by the Americans, to what the singular prosperity and growing strength of that people ought mainly to be attributed. Here it is. The singular thing that attributes why America in the mid-19th century was growing prosperity and strength. Here it is. Here's its conclusion. To the superiority of their women. Even a Frenchman can get that. That's really good. Father, I ask that you would be so kind as to give us your spirit so that we may be the wisest of men and the wisest of women. Lord, we come to celebrate the gift of mothers, wives, and women in general. May we see that the hope of the gospel is that we become the wisest of men. And it's only through the gospel. May we pursue that. Would you give us the wisdom that only you can? Would you give us the righteous only your spirit can produce?